It's that time again, a time where we open the door to the castle and let you take a look inside at what your U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is doing. That's right, it's time for another edition of Corps Connection. Welcome to the March edition of Corps Connection. I'm your host, Patrick Bloodgood. We have a packed episode this month, so let's dive right in. The Los Angeles District is providing technical assistance for FEMA and the state of California in Santa Barbara in the wake of heavy rains to remove debris from basins throughout the county, allowing the basins to restore capacity to handle future rainfall.
During rainfall events in January, Santa Barbara County, California received 11 inches of rain, which filled many of the county's debris basins to capacity. FEMA asked the Los Angeles District to support a debris removal mission in the county. The district deployed team members to provide technical assistance for the mission.
What we're doing here for Santa Barbara County at this time is to provide technical assistance to the county. Some of our experience from the 2018 event is we're sharing some of that, some of the things that we learned, some of its contracting methods, and removal of the and disposal of the debris that we're pulling from the basins. We're helping them to answer some of the questions they have regarding those issues. It's important that the county do the work to remove the debris that's in this basin as quickly as possible because they want to be prepared for the next storm. When there's an excessive amount of debris in the basin has a possibility of plugging the towers, the drains that drain the waters from this basin, and it's actually protecting the residents downstream of this basin.
This mission was reminiscent of one in January 2018 following an early morning debris flow in Montecito, California that took the lives of 23 people. Then, district team members assisted Santa Barbara County with clearing out and removing debris from 11 of the county's debris basins over a three-month period.
In 2018, when I was here, we saw a lot of large boulders, large debris that had come from the upstream hillsides. Some of these boulders were 20, 30 feet tall. We had to have the contractor break them up with hydraulic hammers to break them down so they'd be small enough to haul away in trucks. We haven't seen any evidence of rock that's anywhere near the sizes that we saw at that time. So this allows the trucks to haul the debris and rock and vegetation out of here much faster than what they did in 2018.
Moving from emergency operations to construction operations, the St. Paul District recently completed a rehabilitation project to the Sandy Lake Dam. The project was needed to replace old deteriorating parts to make the dam safer and increase its longevity.
My name is Hunter Simonson. I'm a park ranger with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers at the Sandy Lake Dam and Recreation Area. So in February of 2021, we started the Sandy Lake Dam Rehabilitation Project. This project consisted of two phases to help make some significant repairs to the dam. Some of those improvements included new slide gates, new concrete repairs. The old timber apron on the upstream side was ripped out and replaced with concrete. And then we also had our old stop log bay get transformed into a new dual leaf gate as well. The main reason for the improvements was ultimately for public safety. Some of the concrete on the dam was starting to deteriorate and some of the operating equipment was starting to get to the end of its life. So these upgrades were to provide the structure and integrity of the dam for many years to come. So the big takeaway behind this is that the construction on the dam is now complete and we're excited to be open again this spring for camping.
USACE celebrated the completion of a new facility recently. The Field Research Facility in Duck, North Carolina has a new annex, which will help them with their expanding mission of researching coastal zones.
Dignitaries and local staff at the Coastal Hydraulic Laboratory Field Research Facility, located in Duck, North Carolina, celebrated the opening of a new $4.3 million annex. The new 4,008-square-foot building provides additional capabilities for the 45-year-old facility.
There's a couple of big focus areas of this facility. The first, which we're standing in right now, is our new instrumentation laboratory. So this provides us a space to work on a lot of the new technology that we've been developing here.
Over the years, researchers have been working on several new autonomous vehicles which operate both in and above the surf zone to collect imagery and data.
One of the second big focuses of this facility is increased office space. Our staff has grown tremendously in the last 5 years.
The increased staff is working on advancing the capabilities for ERDC to research littoral zones or coastal areas on behalf of the U.S. military.
Ensuring that our warfighters are really equipped to be able to move through these regions as safely and as efficiently as possible is really one of the main focuses of the research that we're doing here now.
Dr. Brody says the technology and study work being done here also benefits USACE's civil mission.
One of the cool things is that a lot of the technology that we're developing to support the warfighter can also be transitioned to our civil works needs here at home in helping us better understand the processes that are driving evolution of our coasts and arming our district engineers with better tools to quantify storm impacts and make decisions about how to better manage our coastlines.
Coastlines that are enduring sea level rise and more intense storms, making the research here vitally important. From Duck, North Carolina, Patrick Bloodgood.
Finally, the Chief of Engineers, Lieutenant General Scott Spellman, celebrated Engineers Week by highlighting three areas where your U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is working to create the future through multiple missions that USACE is working on for our nation and its warfighters.
Hello, team. My name is Lieutenant General Scott Spellman, 55th Chief of Engineers and Commanding General of your U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. Happy 2023 National Engineers Week. I am privileged to lead some of the world's most talented engineers, scientists, physicists, and mathematicians in the world. Their mission is to apply their ingenuity and innovative thought towards making life safer and more prosperous for everyone. This year's theme for Engineers Week is creating the future. From managing our nation's water resources, to overseeing the design and construction of incredible infrastructure, to innovating through research and development, our experts have an important role in helping to shape the future of our great nation. Behind me is one key example. This is the construction site of what will be the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency's new campus, West. Just like this critical project, much of our work goes to delivering facilities that support the readiness of our warfighters and their families. Let me give you just a couple of examples. One of the ways we're working to help create the future is by supporting the Department of Defense education activity in the design and construction of 21st century schools, not just here in the United States, but at U.S. military installations around the world. Here's a bit more about that incredible program.
Across the world and right here at home, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is supporting the Department of Defense education activity through the Defense Agency's Military Construction Funded Program to replace or renovate current schools to 21st century design standards. These new facilities provide students and teachers with state-of-the-art classrooms, rooms that provide 21st century technology, innovative collaboration spaces, and creative design that enhances student-teacher interaction. These new schools better prepare students for college and careers in the 21st century. USACE and its design and construction partners have built 6 new schools in the past year. Schools like the Patch Barracks Elementary in Germany. This 134,973 square foot, $46.9 million facility accommodates 551 pre-K through 5th grade students. The school design included 6 neighborhood areas with studios, hubs, and group learning areas, as well as one-on-one spaces. The spaces can be adapted with the help of movable walls.
The school is actually a tool to help teaching and learning. and it fosters, because of the open concept in the neighborhoods and the learning studios, it fosters 21st century skills that we call them the four C's, which are communication, collaboration, critical thinking, and creativity. And the flow between the studios and the interaction between the teachers and the co-planning and the co-teaching allows all of that to happen to better teach our kids.
Military-dependent students in Okinawa, Japan at Bob Hope Elementary have a similar setup in this $72.8 million, 136,155 square foot school. The school also features classrooms without walls, collaborative teaching spaces, as well as bouncing ball chairs and laptop docking stations.
The core learns from every single project, the Bauamps learn from every single project, as do we, and I think each project as we go forward gets better and better because of the lessons we've learned from the previous projects. So it's just a great partnership.
Nationwide waterborne transportation is the U.S. supply chain. Nearly half of all consumer goods purchased by Americans pass through harbors maintained through dredging by the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. Here's a little bit more about our role in helping to create ports of the future.
With 90% of the world's trade conducted via waterborne means and $1.5 trillion in goods flowing through our ports annually, which support more than 13 million jobs across the nation, America's ports need to be ready to receive and ship goods from and to the rest of the world from wider, longer, and deeper drafting ships. USAIS, along with its dredging industry partners, are working with the nation's ports to make sure they are ready to receive the ships of the future. Since 2017, the Army Corps of Engineers has worked to deepen 9 harbors and connected channels. And currently, it's in the process of working on 12 harbor and channel deepening projects to accommodate post-Panamax-sized vessels. The Corps is also studying an additional 9 projects for potential future deepening, keeping our nation at the forefront of commercial trade.
The harbor deepening project here in Charleston was transformational for us. We have the ability to claim for our customers the deepest harbor on the East Coast. And I think that for a region that is dependent on exporting as well as importing, that extra depth is really a benefit for our customers. It is a benefit for our ocean carriers. It has tremendous positive economic impact on our state.
Today, our engineers and scientists are constantly looking for new and innovative ways to reduce the risk from flooding, especially along our nation's coast. From traditional structures like flood walls and bulkheads to natural solutions like barrier islands, coastal storm risk management systems are some of the most innovative solutions in the country.
Coastal communities, both large and small, are experiencing the effects of sea level change and the associated increase in the extent and depth of inundation due to coastal storms. Throughout our nation, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is partnering with many of these communities to formulate, design, and construct solutions to help mitigate the risks these storms pose. USAIS has more than 70 coastal storm risk management feasibility studies or projects that are in the pre-construction and design phase. In the last fiscal year, USAIS had more than 90 CSRM projects under construction, which include beach and dune renourishment projects. In addition to 2022 annual fiscal year funding for coastal storm risk management measures, the bipartisan infrastructure law directed USAIS to work on an additional $2.5 billion worth of coastal storm risk management solutions. These solutions include structural and non-structural measures and natural and nature-based features like beach berms, dunes, seawalls, flood walls, storm surge barriers, elevating and/or flood-proofing structures to manage risks from coastal storms to neighborhoods and critical infrastructure in vulnerable areas. With nearly 40% of our nation's population living near the coast, investments and work like this will manage risk to economic centers and communities from coastal storms well into the future.
So we've seen more high tide events in the last 20 years than we have in the last 70. We've been tracking the data for a while. And so when you add the extreme events on top of the other issues, you know, we're just getting inundated with flooding pretty frequently, and it's impacting a lot of residents and businesses. So in partnership with the Norfolk District of the Army Corps, we've come up with a recommended plan to hold back at the edge these storm surges, these major catastrophic events.
Again, everyone, happy National Engineers Week. We are proud of our role in applying engineering solutions to help solve some of our nation's toughest challenges and help create the future. If you're interested in a career with us, visit usajobs.com. We're always looking for great talent. SAONS, Army Strong, Building Strong.
To all our engineers, scientists, and support staff, thank you for what you do for our nation. That wraps up this edition of Core Connection. We will see you again next month. Until then, I'm Patrick Bloodgood, and this has been Core Connection.